And this is one of our quarterly meetings. So every sort of 3 or 4 months, we try and pull a subject off the table and have a look at it a bit more thoroughly. And this is one of those things. In fact, it's a two-part meeting. We're going to have this meeting on Zoom this morning. And then in September, we're going to have a face-to-face meeting, which you're all invited to, which Kate will mention at the end of the meeting. By the way, it's very nice to see Kate back with us. Kate, our chair, who's been away for some time, and she's back with us this morning, so that's lovely. So that is the plan, and we're going to go through to 11 o'clock this morning, so an extra half hour this morning is the plan as well. Welcome to people that have not been with us before. Lots of people have come here regularly on a Friday morning, where we talk about stuff and look at stuff going on in Cumbria and beyond, and champion bits and bobs going on in Cumbria, and learn some stuff as well sometimes. And my name is Tom Spate, and I organise these calls and I chair them as well. So all mistakes are mine. Right, so I'm just going to share my screen first of all and just share the agenda for what we're going to do this morning. Here is the plan. Hopefully you can see an agenda on your screen now. This is what we're doing. We're going to hear from Stefan shortly, who is our vice chair. Then a number of case studies. I won't read them out. You can see them there. And by the way, there are subtitles if you need them for this call. And we are recording this call as well. We always record the calls and we put them up on the website and on social media, usually the Monday of the following week. So some case studies that you can see are going to come our way to basically highlight what is going on in Cumbria at the moment, as far as inclusivity and relevance is concerned. Some examples of it. Hopefully time for a bit of a discussion off the back of those case studies, and then a look ahead to this great symposium that Prism and the University of Cumbria are organising. Jane's going to tell us more about that before we then look at next steps with Kate and conclude at 11 o'clock. So that is the plan for this morning. This is the question that we're looking at for the next 90 minutes. Does the Cumbrian arts and culture sector represent and serve all communities across the county? If not, how can we do better? And one of the reasons we're talking about that is because it's one of the Arts Council's investment principles. There are 4 Arts Council investment principles. If you're part of an NPO, you'll be very well aware of these as you've just finished your application to become an NPO, National Portfolio Organisation. But ultimately, it's if you're interested in engaging with the Arts Council, possibly for money, it's very well worth knowing about this. So inclusivity and relevance is about ensuring the creative and cultural sector better reflects and serves all communities across England. It is a commitment to achieving greater fairness, access, and opportunity. So that's the reason that we are focusing on this this morning and that we'll come back to it in September. So enough for me, that is the plan, that's the agenda. I'm glad to see that all the people that are formally speaking for about 10 minutes are in the meeting, so that's great news as well. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen now and I'm gonna hand over to Stefan Escrit, who runs, I want to say Ragged Trousered Productions. It's not Ragged Trousered Productions. I'll let Stefan say what it is. He's our vice chair and is a great theatre maker, producer and creative. So Stefan, over to you.
That's very kind of you, Tom. Yeah, my name is Stefan Escrit. I'm a man in my 50s. I have short grey hair. I'm wearing glasses and headphones and a grey collarless shirt. And I use the pronouns he, him. I'm vice chair, very glad to be vice chair of Cumbria Arts and Culture Network. Tom's covered a lot of what I was going to say to you, but just to point out that the reason we're doing this is that we have been making a point of covering the new strategy that the Arts Council have brought into practice now, built on 4 investment principles. And we've already covered in previous meetings ambition and quality and environmental responsibility. And we look forward in the future to looking at dynamism. But it's really important to look at this particular principle because even the Arts Council themselves acknowledge that this is probably the most important of the 4, and they could take issue with that, but anyone applying for money is obliged to address this investment principle in their application, which is an indication. On the national stage, interesting to see that Cumbria now has 2 Creative People and Places projects, which is relevant to this, but today's question is about our work in this county, and hopefully we're going to see some really inspiring thinking about what people are doing now to address the issues brought up in this very broad, evolving and nuanced subject. the language is changing, and that can be quite a challenge. And we may well look at that in more detail in the September meeting, where we do hope we'll have Arts Council representation. CACN have been trying to address inclusivity and relevance in previous training. In recent times, we had the disability equality training. 56 people attended that. And prior to that, we had the unconscious bias training. And of course, as I hope has been made clear, if people feel there are particular topics, issues that we ought to devote time or training to, please let us know, because that's why we're here. I think that's all I need to say at this stage, because we're really here to listen to some very interesting work from some very interesting people. So I'll hand back to Tom. Thank you.
Thanks, Stefan. So we're going to cross to Jane Dudman at Prism Arts shortly, and she is also waiting for a colleague, Jonathan Harkins, to join her. But before we do that, I just thought we'd cross to Celia Burbush. Celia is an artist based in Keswick. And Celia, come off mute and tell us a bit about your approach to this subject.
Okay, right, I've practiced my 3 or 4 minutes. I focus on the culture around that word inclusion, and also a notion of aspiration and personal growth. The people I learned the most of were Patrick Gilchrist at Theatre by the Lake, who, when he was setting up an operation of a multi-million pound endeavour, he was still the type of person who would make a cup of tea for 20 people. And when he interviewed people for top jobs, everyone in the organisation, the cleaner, the bar staff, the box office staff, would meet that candidate and they would feed back into it with a legacy that they would go on to further their own practices, because it's saying you're important. So I take a lot from his model, Anne Timpson, Ali McCaw and Kath Coulthard are making space. So I'm just putting those out there as wider research, people to talk to, of which all of you know. So that's one idea of a culture that you kind of know when you're working with organisations, how you meet them, where they are at with inclusion, that it's not an added thing. There might be policies around how they work, but it's literally how they treat you. And who you meet within the organisation. And so I think organisations only need to look at that of the culture within them, and to play with that to inform themselves on that. This idea of personal growth and excellence, it's the idea of I treat everybody as an individual. I'm going to leap straight into a project I'm doing with the Kirk Gates. This idea that I want to hear from people, and I want to grow with them, is this sort of humbleness of a position of learning. So the model I'm used with the Kirk Gate is really something that comes from other fields, but it's co-research using arts-based methods. So it's obviously the arts, and you're obviously using art, but you're purposely saying that you're framing it to work with people, and you've got all as much knowledge as each other, and that's performing inclusivity without saying it's inclusive. You're just doing the work, but you're doing it with people, and you're sort of humbling yourself to learn with them. So I've worked with community school groups, finding out sort of communities of interest, communities of geography within that are in that area around Kirkgate who wanted to reach out to new audiences and communities, and working with their sort of satellite communities in Merriport, and to sort of raise sort of research is about an open-ended question. So by its general shape, it is democratic. So that's another way to frame it, even though we might bring the work to finished art conclusion, sort of art-based conclusions. So I'd take top, I mean, in this particular project, we've taken local research points of local heritage, which of course I know a lot of the people in this room will deal with that kind of thing, but the Kirkgate happens to hold a collection, and so we looked at riverside trades, and I always use a method of reenactment with participants, give them that space and time to re-experience methods, so they're upskilling, and that kind of has an aspirational gain, and I always get professional artists of all different methods and methodologies to come and join me on that, or reference sort of local artists who've gained that national stage, kind of gained that national, international recognition. But what we've done is taken that research to a point where we then have formed a programme of workshops that then become part of Kirkgate's programme. And that then goes back to who has generated that programme? Well, it's the communities of Highfield, or it's the people at the settlement that you know live in Maryport area. So it means that your programme directly has been grown by the people that you wouldn't normally necessarily be engaging with. So, but it's a point of I always act like I'm a, I know that I'm a stranger when I come into a community, so I build that time to get to know them and listen. When I work with organisations and ask this, you can immediately know whether they're capable of listening. But really listening is an important point to build that in. But then that idea to, there's a book that I want to mention to everyone that's a big influence on me, which is Method Meets Art by Patricia Levy. Big influence in terms of that case of why arts-based methods work within that kind of research model. And another book is Cultural Democracy and the Right to Make Art by Alison Jeffers, that came out the last couple of years. Celia, I think that's me. Yes.
That's great. Thank you. If you could pop those, could you pop links to both those books into chat before you disappear? Because I know you're disappearing before 10. That would be really useful. And that's a really interesting, good example of work that you've been doing. So thank you so much for that. Let's cross to Carlisle. I think Jane and Jonathan are in Carlisle. Jane is with Prism Arts and Jonathan is an artist that works with Prism Arts. Very nice to see you both. One of the reasons that we're having this conversation today is because of the symposium that Prism Arts are organising, which we'll hear about more shortly in a couple of weeks' time. But Jane, over to you to get a perspective from you and Jonathan.
So if it's okay, we're going to start with some questions for Jonathan, because Jonathan will be doing a singing session this morning at Prism Arts with one of our new artists who's coming in to deliver on a Friday, Victoria Barbe. So he's running a singing session. So we're going to let Jonathan go as soon as we can. But I just have questions. So Jonathan, would you tell everybody what barriers you experience as an artist for getting involved?
Just lack of experience for one part, and just not getting the breaks at the moment.
And I can elaborate on these things later. Could you say something about how you like to develop your work?
Well, I've got a play, if any of you are interested. I
Jane and Jonathan, if you can just come a bit closer to the microphone, that would be great. Thank you.
Sorry. This computer is a bit hopeless, I'm afraid. You have to
carry on. That's great. Carry on.
Okay. So, Jonathan, you were just saying that you have a play that you want to develop to stage.
Yeah, and wondering if any of you are interested. I just need your email, so I can email it to you.
So, Stefan has had a look at that.
Yeah.
Hasn't he? So, that's sort of in process. We're also looking at an exhibition for you next year, aren't we?
Solo
exhibition. Yeah. So, Jonathan has produced amazing work to go into the symposium exhibition, haven't you?
Yeah.
And also, he's part of the Tully House Board.
Yeah.
So, very engaged generally in the scene, in the arts and culture scene in Carlisle and surrounding area.
Yeah.
But I think not really the break, and the lack of experience is really key. And I'll talk some more about that, why that might be.
Yeah, that's literally fine,
absolutely brilliant. So I'm gonna let you go to your session now.
Okay,
is that all right?
Will you need me for anything else?
No, thank you very much.
Are you all right if I read this one from you?
Okay, thanks Jonathan. I didn't want to keep Jonathan too long, but I'm gonna read you a quote from Jonathan about the work that he does at Tully House. Which he's given me to read out. I like being at Tully House meetings because I enjoy meeting like-minded people. It's good to feel part of this group. It does wonders for my mental health. I also like helping to make decisions about the museum and our community's future. But of course, what thrills me more than anything about Tully House meetings are it's the journey we are on towards the future that excites me. journey where decisions are made covering future cultural events for the benefit of our community. So, I mean, we have somebody in Jonathan, and he is not alone in the people who come to Prism Arts, of having this incredible drive and commitment to the life of the cultural community, life of Carlisle, basically an area. Jonathan's from Carlisle. But I think that lack of experience and not getting the breaks is really key into why he cannot develop. And that is very much to do with, I'm just going to close the door, the social model of disability not generally being applied. So I'm just going to read you some stuff and then I'm gonna stop quite early. But what I wanted to just to say is that from Prism Art's point of view, our complete vision is art without those barriers. So those barriers that Jonathan and everybody that comes to Prism Arts experience in terms of developing their work. So Jonathan's saying, I've got a play. He wants to get that play seen. He wants to realise that ambition. And it's a real ambition, and he's a really good writer. But the way that we look at contemporary art, and that's of all forms, is that it is valued by the ability of the maker to articulate their work and validate their work through a set of sort of specialist language. So when anybody gets an application from an artist, generally it's like, this is what we expect. It needs to be articulated in a certain way. The Arts Council are as guilty as that as anybody. But that is, even thinking about making an application is a huge thing. And then if you have to do it in that sort of conceptual, complex framework to explain your work, it's a massive barrier. Regardless of how amazing the work is. So even just getting past that to show the work is huge. It's a huge barrier. So at Prism Arts, so yes, we're art without barriers, and our mission is delivering art programmes and creating space for excellent work that empowers people with disabilities to drive their own creative journey as artists, leaders and advocates for change. And so everybody at Prism Arts is on their own journey, and they're all different, those journeys. Somebody's journey can be moving from not holding a paintbrush to making a painting, not wanting to be involved with paint to actually making a painting. And somebody else's journey can be like Jonathan, who actually is a potential leader and advocate for change and can really drive things forward. And all of those are on an equal level and footing. It's not a hierarchy. People have different needs and different abilities and different contributions, and that's really, really important to remember. So in the Arts Council, so inclusive arts generally, in England, there's 14.1 million people who report having a disability. 1.5 million report a learning disability. That's a huge number of people. From a MenCap survey, these communities remain really isolated. Almost a third of 18 to 35 year olds with learning disabilities spend less than an hour a day outside their home. And those homes are not necessarily stimulating or supportive. There's obviously a massive range. And the dual issue of age, disability and income all comes together and affects that person's agency in the world, really. And that's what we're talking about, people with disabilities' agency in the world. And obviously I'm talking about disability because that's Prism Arts. And there are lots of other issues with inclusivity, which is other people will come on to talk about. But I experienced something recently, which was an access issue for one of our artists who is a wheelchair user. And I talked to that person, the venue, and use the term taking it on the chin. Our artists and people with disabilities have a lifetime of taking it on the chin, of turning up to places and not being able to get in. And that's not just because of a physical disability, that can be all sorts of other sensory issues, inability to actually read instructions, all those sorts of things. And actually the social model of disability, which flips disability over from that medical model, is like, what is your disability? It's like, how are you disabled? How are people disabled by the environment, by access, by the way that things are set up? And I'm going to finish with other things. There's a really good 7 principles of inclusion, which is really good. And I can send a link to that. And it's We Shall Not Be Removed, produce these 7 principles. And they are basically to do with the Equality Act. Everything should be done with a social model of disability. Everything should be co-produced. It's a customer journey. The disabled audiences and visitors must be thoroughly mapped. Disabled people are an important cultural asset in the UK. And organisations should ensure that they celebrate diversity. But I'm going to leave you with this quote, which is from Jacques Derrida. And he says, which I love this, it says, by repeating what is implicit in the founding concepts of the original problem, by using against the edifice the instruments or stones available in the house, we risk ceaselessly confirming and consolidating that which we allegedly deconstruct. So meaning, if we constantly look at what we already do and the accepted status quo as a way of fixing things, we're going to fail, right? Because what it does is confirms that. What we need to do is find new building blocks, yeah, find new instruments that actually think about that social model and turn it on its head. So if we're not including, we're excluding. But how we do that? And there's so much good work happening, and there is so much positivity. We work with some amazing partners that are just constantly looking at this, learning from this, thinking about how they can do things better. And that for us is hugely positive, hugely positive. And I have no criticisms of anybody who is just trying to learn more about working this way. And this, for instance, this Zoom is really shows that people actually are really looking to do more, just fantastic. But I think it's a basic way of looking at inclusion, not as something that is a sort of paternalistic, we really do need to include people, but actually how that enriches the whole environment, the whole cultural sphere for everybody. So it's not about allowing people to join in, it's actually how that enriches the environment. And Prism Arts, when we have activity that is integrated, and we've got artists working with our artists, we've got staff, we've got other people coming in and students, it is a really wonderful, very dynamic environment where everybody is valued. And it's a bit utopian, really. It's just like, it doesn't always work, but that's the vision, you know. It's just like, actually it can work beautifully. So I'm just going to leave it there. Jane, sorry, we didn't even show any slides, Tom. Completely forgot about those.
We've got plenty of slides to come. Jane, we'll come back to Jane towards the end of the meeting to talk a bit more about what's happening on the 5th of July. But I happen to have just dug out to kind of just reinforce some of what Jane was saying there about the social model of disability. 56 of us recently did some training with Michelle Taylor. You may have been one of those people through the network to understand what the social model of disability actually is. This is just a sort of 2.5 minute film I'm going to share with you, which if you don't know what it is, helps explain it. And if you do know what it is, it reminds you what's actually meant by that phrase. So I'm just going to share my screen and share this little film with you.
Thank you, Tom.
That's fine. That's fine. Okay, just bear with me. Here it is. Share sound, Tom.
According to the medical model of disability, the word disabled means less able. Less able to achieve your potential, less able to have meaningful relationships, less able to play an active part in the world around you, and that this is just your bad luck. This outdated view of the world puts the responsibility of overcoming disabling barriers on the person with an impairment. But this idea is changing. The more modern social model of disability says that a person doesn't have a disability, but that they are disabled. They are disabled by society. It is the attitudes and physical barriers imposed on them by society that prevents them from achieving their potential. The social model was developed by disabled people and their allies to help them take action against discrimination and to empower people to find solutions, remove barriers, and campaign together for equality and human rights. They showed how people with lots of different impairments face many of the same problems. These disabling barriers include prejudiced opinions and attitudes, restricted access, and people being systematically excluded. The social model looks for the ways that society can be planned and organised in order to provide accessibility, independence, and opportunity in a way that enables people rather than disables them. What we learn from the social model of disability is that disability is a social construct created by social barriers, barriers which can be eliminated. We learn that it is the responsibility of government, public spaces, businesses, and individual people to make the changes, to increase the access, and build a more equal society where everyone has the opportunity to reach their full potential.
Okay, so there we go. Social model of disability. If that's new for you, that's a really interesting concept to start thinking about. I learned about it a couple of months ago, and I am thinking differently about, oh, let me just pause that YouTube. It's a different way of thinking about it, and I certainly learned and engaged differently now with thinking about disability. Jane, thank you so much for that. We're going to come back to Jane and to Carlisle, but now we're going to cross to Simon McKelligott, who is works with communities at Theatres by the Lake. I've probably got your title wrong there, Simon. Simon was at the Knotted Project before then and did some fantastic work there. So Simon, over to you to tell us a little bit more about what Theatres by the Lake perhaps are doing in this area.
Sure. Good morning, everybody. My name's Simon. I'm a 30-year-old white male. I'm wearing a black T-shirt, got short dark hair, and I'm sadly got COVID. I'm sitting at home with COVID. So if I give you zombie vibes this morning, I apologise. I'm going to start off by giving you a little bit of context as to kind of, I've got a page of A4 that I'm going to set myself a little timer so I know where I'm up to. So my role is as the Community Engagement Manager at Theatre by the Lake, and I've kind of joined the organisation about 5 months ago at a period of significant change, I would say, for the theatre. So my role is very much focused on trying to help the theatre open out and connect with the people that live around it and interact with, trying to help people interact with us in a different way and to try and open out the theatre more and more as we move forward. So the theatre has adopted a whole new business model of looking outwards and trying to be more relevant to the community and reflective of the people that live around us. It's the idea is very much focused on trying to open out the theatre and to try and share what happens within our spaces and within the work that we produce. And through that, trying to welcome people in a whole new way. So looking forward, we're kind of planning about kind of big long-term quality programmes, theatre making and skills development that will hopefully embrace local people and the stories as well, and making sure that we're making those stories at the heart of our work. In order to deliver all of this work that we're so passionate about, we absolutely know that inclusivity and relevance is a crucial part of it, and it has to be built into everything that we're doing. So our current approach is to try and move forward with this philosophy of catering to every individual. And that's something that I'm personally very, very passionate about. And I've been a theatre maker and kind of a theatre practitioner for a long time. And it's crucial that, yeah, it's not a one size fits all approach. And that's very much at the heart of everything that we're trying to do at Theatre by the Lake at the moment. We're trying to introduce this kind of culture of this internal culture of listening and responding, so making sure that we're actually opening out, having conversations, and trying to apply that to everything that we're doing and planning, and trying to make sure that the theatre is an inclusive and accessible experience for everybody. Given the time, I'm going to whip through just a few key areas of kind of focus, and then yeah, there's plenty more kind of fleshing out and detail that I'm sure I could add to this following this kind of chat if it's interesting to everybody. So our building, we've just done an access audit on our venue, which was really interesting, and any changes that have been recommended in that audit we're going to do. You know, we're going to make sure that that happens, make sure that our space is a welcoming one, and one that makes everybody comfortable and that they can come and have the fullest experience just as anyone else. So very much like we've just been talking about, the social model of disability, that was very inspiring to us. I think a number of us from the theatre took part in the training that CACN presented a few weeks back. And yeah, we're very much trying to follow that and keep that at the heart of what we're doing. And then more on the kind of advocacy side, we're trying to think about our building as a space where it can be a kind of a centre for positive messaging and advocacy, and making sure that stories aren't censored and, you know, voices can be heard in our spaces, and anyone that wants to say something can say something and use our kind of platform and our venue to do that and communicate with people. So we're planning all sorts of really cool projects that enable people to say their piece and hopefully use us as a springboard to do that and to reach more people. So I'm very excited about all that. With our shows and our artists, that's an area that we're always trying to develop in terms of inclusion. We're trying to present a broad and varied programme with audiences and participants able to watch and take part in different ways as we move forward. So we're doing BSL interpreted shows and relaxed performances. We're trying to make sure that that's kind of, I mean, it should be standard anyway, so it is standard for us now. We're making sure that that happens. And then with the new kind of business model, this kind of outward looking approach, we're trying to make sure that the theatre doesn't have to happen purely in our theatre. We're trying to make sure that going forward we can plan to actually make theatre and co-create theatre and take it out to people out in those communities, so that there's not a, because Cumbria is huge, so you know, there's not an hour and a half drive for someone just to see a piece of theatre if they haven't got a car, if they can't afford the travel. So going forward, you know, we're not quite there yet, but it's absolutely our intention to try and take the theatre out to people and to kind of reduce those barriers and remove them, to try and share the theatre making process and performance experiences and kind of flip it on its head and make sure that it's out there and it's accessible. In terms of our cast and our team and the artists that we work with, we're continually seeking to employ a diverse team, and we're trying to make our recruitment process more inclusive. You know, we're trying to have the conversations early in a process with every individual and make sure that we are not making assumptions when we employ somebody, and making sure that we can kind of put the changes in place that are needed to make someone's experience working with the theatre as smooth as possible and as inclusive as possible. Our staff. So our staff, we fully recognise that currently we are a completely white staff team. So we acknowledge that that's where we are, but we're not. So we are a diverse team of staff, but we're not an ethnically diverse team of staff. And it's something that we recognise and that we're passionate about, kind of not shying away from. You know, it's very important to us that everyone feels welcome in our building and connecting with us. So we've been doing a lot of work, and we will continue to do a lot of work, making sure that anyone of any ethnicity feels welcome in our space. And that it doesn't feel like a closed door purely on what you see on our staff headshots. And that's something that we're not going to shy away from. We're going to continue to work on and keep handling, keep chatting about it, because it can't not be spoken about. Our staff, another area where our staff are developing is the training. So we've already mentioned some training this morning, but we've been doing lots and lots of courses in lots of areas. I, for instance, have attended some like neurodiversity training and things like that. We're doing LGBTQIA plus training, and that's also being passed on to our board as well. So our board are also adopting that training, which is fantastic. So we're trying to make sure that there's a kind of culture of learning and opening minds, and hopefully that will keep filtering through everything that we're doing. Partnerships, we've got some amazing partnerships. We work with companies like Grey Eye, we work with Prism to kind of improve our awareness of work with people with disabilities and deaf and disabled artists. We're running a writer's course for deaf and disabled artists. So hopefully, I know we've already spoken to Stefan, so Jonathan hopefully could benefit from that course. So I'll make sure that everything gets passed on with that shortly. So that's specifically about disabled writers getting their plays out there. So that's what it's for, but we're trying to do that more and more and make sure that kind of that opportunity is carved out in our program and in our space. And then I'm going to quickly whip through governance. So a massive part of the governance change that I'm excited about is that we're building in a community advisory board in the future. So this is a really bold move. And this is one where we are, we're going to recruit a diverse group of people from the people that live around Theatre by the Lake in Cumbria. And they're going to have a direct channel of communication with our board. It's going to be direct, sitting face to face, having conversations, not making assumptions on behalf of the people that we're serving. We're actually going to sit down and have the chat. So I'm really excited about that. It's going to be lighter touch than a typical kind of board responsibility. So hopefully that will make it more accessible. And we're going to try and, just build something that's really, really exciting and really hopefully empowering, and that can bring us close to the people that we're trying to connect with and serve. We've also got an inclusivity and relevance working group at the theatre as well. So staff meet every couple of weeks, and I sit on that as well, where we don't shy away from these conversations, and we sit down together and we have the chat, and we kind of dig into some of the issues, and we're trying to look at ourselves. We've only been doing that for a couple of months so far, but we're going to continue doing it, looking at the language that we use, the way that we're communicating, how accessible our opportunities are or are not, and not shying away from it and just kind of handling that. And then to close, because I know we're on time in a bit, just to basically say, do we currently serve everyone in our community in Cumbria? Probably not. I'm going to say we don't yet. Is it our intention to? Absolutely. And we're trying to make all the positive steps in the right way. And we very much see it as kind of a journey and a conversation. So if anyone ever feels that we can improve, it's an open door. We're up for the chat. So please feel free to get in touch and share your opinions on how we can do better. So that was a whirlwind. Thanks, Tom.
Thank you very much. Lots of stuff going on there at Theatre by the Lake in Keswick. Some stuff in chat for you there, Simon, to have a look at as well. Thank you for people putting into that conversation there. Right, that's a great to listen to. The point of this meeting is to open up this conversation. We've got part two coming up in September where we might be able to put together some actions. But what's great about this meeting is we're hearing case studies going on around Cumbria of the challenges people are facing, but also the work that's going on. So let's now cross to Dave Camlin, who's one of the most creative people, I think, in Cumbria. Dave's a great musician and all sorts of other things as well. And I've invited Dave to give us a few thoughts as well. And Dave, I've got your slide. So if you'd like to come off mute, over to you.
Great, thanks, Tom. Actually, it's great listening to the discussion. I'd like to start with a provocation, because I get quite I'm not sure what the word is, not uncomfortable, but just kind of a little bit jangly around the edges around terms like access and inclusion, purely for the fact that as language, it's been like there've been really dominant parts of the discourse in arts and culture for at least 25 years, and for at least the first 20 of those years, cultural inequalities grew. So, you know, from the start of the noughties through to certainly through to like 2015 and the Warwick report, access and inclusion and discussion of access and inclusion was a really, you know, a really key part of cultural discourse. And at the same time, cultural inequalities grew. So I always have the suspicion or the kind of niggling discomfort that talking about access and inclusion might be one of the ways that cultural inequalities are perpetuated. And I know that might seem really provocative, but I think for me, it's a really important one to, you know, I want to know that I'm not part of the problem. I think we all want to know that we're not part of the problem. And I think one of the things that, you know, certainly there was a period in a quite recent past when we said we were doing a lot to address these issues of access and inclusion, and actually that wasn't what was happening. So I think there's, in terms of being critical of our own discourse, I think we need to think about that. I know that's probably a bit too deep and everything for a meeting like this, but I thought I'd say it just because it's, I was thinking it. Next slide, Tom, actually, please. And the first point that I wanted to make was that if we're thinking about, and it's great that people are talking about cultural democracy, but if we're talking about developing a capabilities approach to culture, then we have to recognise that cultural capabilities are not just developed in publicly funded initiatives. You know, I'm sure everybody in the meeting can think of culture that is being created in their community or within their networks that isn't part of any organisation's programme, that isn't receiving any funding, but that is to do with people, you know, just making culture because that's what they want to do. And when we set up Soulfest, that was very much along those lines. It was about, you know, let's just make a festival. And I think the sheer amount of cultural capabilities that were developed, certainly in the first 5 years of that, were phenomenal. But none of those were outputs for any organisation. None of those were reported to Arts Council. I know Soulfest gets lots of Arts Council funding now, but I think Soulfest grew out of really grassroots activity, you know, stuff that was going on at the Carnegie group of artists, the Cumbria, just kind of deciding wanting to do something a little bit bigger. But it was completely off the radar of funding pots and things like that. So I think it's important to remember that culture is much bigger than you know, any network that can accommodate it. Next slide, Tom. Tom asked me to talk about some of the things I'm doing. I'm sure people probably are aware of the Recovery College, but if you're not, it's really worth checking out. So the North Cumbria Recovery College has been running for about 6 months, I think. And I know some people in the meeting are probably involved in it, and there are other artists that people know that are involved in it. But I think it's a great initiative in terms of supporting people in the recovery of their and maintenance of their mental health, and they're, you know, they're in a range of programs on a weekly basis, as well as offering offering talking therapy and the other kinds of things. There's a lot of arts within the Recovery College, and I think for me that feels like a really good way of getting to people, of meeting people, of working with people that I might not otherwise encounter in my kind of my day-to-day work. What, next slide, please. So I feel like, what's his name on there? I've got some nice pictures. I can't think of the guy's names, all the COVID. Next slide, please. For me, in terms of relevance, the where my kind of head is at the minute is, and I don't want to go over, I know you've talked about environmental issues, but the idea that the environment is a universal moral imperative is something that feels like is always relevant. The project that I'm doing this summer is Earth Song, which is a living installation, and actually having a cross arts approach to it we're kind of finding as a way of reaching people that wouldn't necessarily think of coming and getting involved in one of the arts, but different ways in, different ways of engaging families. The songwriting aspect of it has been working in a couple of schools to develop song ideas, and then some of those song ideas we're involving like age concern groups in developing those, so that by September, when we have the big event at Longlands Lake for World Rivers Day, that what we're hoping to do is kind of bring together a real broad cross-section of the community, from the children and young people from Egremont and Whitehaven that have been involved in making the song, through to the age concern groups in Cleeter that we were working with, as well as kind of regular choirs and the people that are connecting with Longlands Lake and the natural world through West Cumbria Rivers Trust and the work that they're doing down at Longlands. Yeah, Marion, you're absolutely right. Those dogs are very well behaved. Yeah. Next slide, please. And the point I wanted to finish on was to kind of connect some of these things back, is to do with the civic imagination. The civic imagination essentially is a disavowal of politics. It's taking the stance that we can't expect politicians to provide solutions for the complex challenges that we face as a species and as a planet. And there are a number of dialects of the civic imagination which are about redistributing power and privilege, which we've heard some of today. And I absolutely applaud the work that Jane Prism Arts are doing. But also the dialects of the civic imagination are about building community solidarity and solving problems. So I think that's kind of what I want to leave you with. I mean, I've got a book coming out in the autumn, which is called Music Making in the Civic Imagination, which is trying to thinking in a more post-human way about how do we move past the place that we're currently in as a species on a fragile planet, and how might in this instance specifically music making and the performance of values, of post-humanistic values through music making, be part of a solution towards, or part of a way of imagining a better future that includes everybody within that notion. I'll finish there.
Dave, thank you. Great images, by the way, and richly rewarding the work that you're doing. And you've found time to write a book as well. You're a remarkable man. Dave, thank you very much indeed for that. Really interesting perspective on stuff going on in Dave's world and beyond. Let's cross now to Wordsworth Grasmere. Again, I'm just trying to give you a great offering of different projects, organisations, individual artists who are doing work in this area, to get our minds thinking about how we can do it better. And that question was, does the Cumbrian arts and culture sector represent and serve all communities across the county? If not, how can we do better? So let's cross to Wordsworth Grasmere and to Jeff Cowton, one of the leaders at Wordsworth Grasmere, who's also, Jeff, I'll get your slides up and the Thank floor you. Is yours.
Thank you. I'm conscious yesterday that we, for those who don't know us, we're based around Wordsworth Cottage, William and Dorothy's Cottage in Grasmere, in the heart of the Lake District. I've been with the Trust for 40 years now. And when I first came, we were opening our new museum. By chance yesterday, we opened our new museum. Maybe that's how you know you've been there too long, when you see two new museums opening when you're there. But the contrast between the two could not have been greater. 40 years ago, it was people you might say you were in awe of, the important people in the world, the funding people, the politicians. Yesterday, when we opened, it was a very friendly affair with people who have come, I hope, to feel that they can be at home with us. And that's a major transformation. We've got further to go. We've all got further to go. But I would suggest that journey, even 15 years ago, is a major transformation from where we were. And that's not complacency. It's just an interesting contrast. in the Arts Council, it talks about better reflecting. And I think we can say that we have better reflecting, but as I say, that journey is still to go. There's our first slide. So that's the transformation. That's the cottage as it appears today. We do serve the county. We're open for local people. It's free access, but also aware, of course, that it's expensive, not only in admission, but also in travel for an increasing number of people. So it's available. The reading room, the research room is available to everybody. 40 years ago, you had to have two references and the permission of the trustees to even come into the reading room. Nowadays, you're very welcome. Just give us an email. So that, you could say, is better serving. The exhibition, I think, can we go to the next picture? Please. I realise this is sort of a slightly old slide. You'll recognise some of these people, and they're a little older now. But the main exhibition, the main museum, represents a number of voices. Here, for example, the Dove Cottage Young Poets Group, who have the final word in the exhibition. About Wordsworth, about Dorothy, the final word are these good people responding to Wordsworth in the present world. We have local hill farmers responding to Wordsworth's poem on Michael. Could I see the next one, please? In the exhibition on Dorothy Wordsworth, there's a section by Grasmere WI. This may not seem very special, but for us, having Grasmere people, having a voice in our exhibition is a move forward. There's a great divide, the A591 it's called, between ourselves and people who live locally. And yesterday, to have local people feel at home is better serving. Certainly with 15 years ago, it's a step forward. Barrow Vision Support are represented in the exhibition. The Arrow Ace, the community, is represented in the exhibition, all about Dorothy's life and work. Can I have the next picture, please? I love this picture. These are artists with Prism Art who came and spent a day with us. I think it was March or April. And they just spent a day in Dove Cottage in the garden. And they're creating work. Jonathan was among them. It was wonderful to see Jonathan again this morning, and Katie as well. And they will have the next exhibition in our smaller gallery in the museum coming up in the summer. The next one, please, Tom. The next major exhibition in the place of Dorothy Wordsworth will be work, words, music by people who are homeless, living in Manchester or Lancaster or Kendal. If you know Wordsworth's lyrical ballads of 1798, he wrote 23 poems about people living, if you like, on the edges of society. These folks read those poems, they recognized themselves in it, and they wish to rewrite Wordsworth for the 21st century. So that will be our next exhibition in September and October. The next one, please, Tom, if we could. This again, you might say, well, in edges of diversity, maybe not great, but for us it is, because these are folks who live in the southwest of the county, and they responded to Wordsworth's poems on the Duddon Valley. And they created this beautiful textile work, which formed another of our major exhibitions last year. And they tell us how much they now feel much more engaged with their locality, with the history, and what a difference it's made. This exhibition at our place has now been seen in four different venues since in their area since created. So again, for us, better serving the people of the area. Can I have the next one, please? Sorry, I've gone through soon, never mind. What I was gonna talk about, schools. We work with 5,000 or engage with 5,000 schools and pupils throughout Cumbria, and that's spread across the county. So 30% of our engagements are in Barrow, 21% in Allerdale, and we go out to the schools, of course, as well as, we're hoping to be able to fund the schools to come to us. This is our community work focused largely in the north of the county, Hospice at Home, West Cumbria, where we introduce poetry into, if you like, the experience of the nurses who were skeptical to start with, but then each wrote a line of poetry in answer to these two questions, put the lines together to create the poems, and they found a new way of expressing. So poetry helping in Hospice at Home. So I think there's the next picture as well, please, Tom, if you could. So this is Wigton, taking the idea of the Wordsworth garden shelter, the moss that they had, and building one in Wigton, Wildlife for Wigton. In terms of our outreach work, 45% of that is in Allerdale, 25% in Eden. I mentioned these figures again to show that the geographical spread away from Grasmere and away from the immediate centre of the lakes. In terms of families, workshops throughout the county, 500 in, if you like, engagements, as we call them, don't we, in libraries throughout the county, 33% in South Lakeland, but also 17% in Barrow, Allerdale, and Eden. So again, we're trying to serve the wider geographical county. So we could do more. We've been slow in terms of a different ethnic diversity. We've got a couple of major projects on this at the moment. We've created a community panel, which will include people of different heritage, and hopefully we'll make a difference there. We've begun a project querying the collection, and we hope, again, to take further research and initiatives with that one. I guess to finish with just some thoughts. One is an anxiety about doing enough collectively. That would be quite interesting to know collectively, how much are we doing? Individually, we always feel, as I've said several times, anxieties come through. We could do more. If any of you have been reading Oliver Berkman's 4,000 Weeks, you'll be aware of that sense of our finiteness and how far can we expect of ourselves. Maybe it's more ingenuity and less, if you like, repeating, as we were saying before. And then the other thought is just, you know, reading, this is an interesting list, you might say, of the things we've been doing. I'm conscious too that some of these are repeated activities which might impact the lives of a few people. How much of that should we be doing, the deep engagement, but how much should we be doing of one-off events that might, you know, impact the lives, ever more briefly, if you like, of a wider number of people? Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Jeff. It's great. I think, you know, if we're asking questions at this meeting, I think we're doing a good thing. I think those are good questions that you ask at the end there. Dave also had some questions that he threw out there, I think. So thank you for those, and thank you for those images as well, Jeff. Terrific stuff. Right, let's just finish our journey through Cumbria down the 591 and maybe the 590, something like that. And we'll head to Barrow, and we'll head to Maddie Nicholson, who runs Artgene. And Maddie is going to share her screen and share some thoughts with us as well. Maddie, over to you. If you're still on mute, Maddie, come off mute.
Sorry about that. Okay. There we go. Right. Okay. So hello, everybody. And yeah, thanks for listening to me. I think really what we, you know, what I'm doing here at the end is I feel a bit like I'm resting on the shoulders of everyone else. You've all talked amazingly about the sort of work that you're doing. And I think, you know, I would agree with everything, really. And just to sort of say thank you. You know, I learn stuff in every session that I do like this, you know, in everything that I engage with. So I think that's a sort of a constant process for us all. But really, just to sort of show, you know, what we do at Artgene. So we're an arts company in Barrow and Furness, right down at the bottom. We have a research remit, which is to look at the role of national artists, national and international artists, architects, specialists, and communities in revisioning the social, natural, and built environment. And by that, I mean the social is the most important. That's why it's there. It's first. It's around people. Nothing happens without our engagement with people. And I'm going to go backwards. Whoops. I'm going to go backwards. Oh, and I can't do that. So never mind. And one of the things that's interesting about Barrow for me is that it's a place I've been here now for over 25 years. I see myself as sort of artist in residence in this place, and I'm constantly meeting new and interesting people here that are scooped into the work and the process. But it's an amazing place. It has a fantastic coastline, and it was given by the Royal Society of Arts and Industry in 15 and 16, this designation as being the borough in England, the number one borough with the number and the best number and quality for its natural heritage assets. But also it ranks fifth nationally for health deprivation and disability. And that's pretty major in the country. Only above that is Liverpool. Is Liverpool and Blackpool. So we're dealing with a huge amount of sort of social problems and health problems here. And I think that's sort of where we engage people. So the social is very much about mobilising and empowering people. We're about working with communities to make change. That's the key thing for me. If there's anything I want to leave, we're about trying to mobilise and empower people so that they can make change and we can make change, but work with them. And this is a lovely project that we did at Peel Island, which is a Barbara Council sort of owned island. And this is an A-board from an artist called Jo Ray. And she created this piece, which says, "Some days all this is yours," which I think is a wonderful sort of way of beginning to engage people with place. The project we did here, we worked with hundreds of people throughout the town where they provided all of their delightful things that they had, that they wanted to share with us about Barrow and the whole Furness area. And we created a big cabinet of curiosities in what we call the People's Museum in Peel. And it's still there in the pub in Peel. And it's many, many things. As artists are many things, or people are many things, this has a whole mass of different amazing sort of artifacts and artworks created. And what we were doing here really was validating the stuff of people's lives. We were contextualising their collections alongside the Nobel Prize winning research of Nico Tinbergen, who's an amazing scientist from South Walney, and Nella Last's writing for mass observation. So what I'm saying here is there's no hierarchy. We're constantly trying to put people's work with and in those situations to elevate them, to make them as important. And I think often the importance is the local work, the local people's work. We're often presenting complex ideas in simple ways. And I say in simple ways because, and bite-sized pieces, because I think everyone needs to engage with stuff that they don't know about, that they're interested in a very simple and easy way. And it's often the access into something. So these are beer maps or beer mats for this island setting where we did this pub. Other sort of things that we've done. So we're interested in the natural. So it's anything from national nature reserves and triple SIs to sort of backyards and allotments and brownfield sites. So again, here, there's no hierarchy. It's a very much an equal sort of process. It's everybody and everything. It's incredibly inclusive. And this is a project that we did on North Walney on the National Nature Reserve there, which became a non-civic war memorial in two parts with a large cast iron gate with a whole series of bird sculptures on it. And then a set of numbers, which were formerly where a First World War gun range was. So we often do sort of public artworks or temporary public artworks. But if you're making, I would say one of the things, if you're making work that's right for place, it needs to engage, it needs to be relevant to people and their lives. And I think the work then is constantly better for that. That's a key thing for me. What we try to do is actively listen. That's a phrase I use often. It's about sort of showing, caring, sharing, being generous and genuine with your time, skills, resources and friendships. So really it should be key and part of who you are and what you're about. And these are images of the process for that work on North Walney. And the project we've been doing very recently has been Extreme Views, where we're linking our communities and our landscapes together. And it's been an ongoing project that we've had for many years, really. But formalised in this Extreme Views programme, which is a long running conversation we've been having with people, this place, our environment and climate change. And here we brought 40 local people and 40 experts from the rest of the world together to look at this place and how we engage with this place and make it more accessible to everyone. And as part of that, we did a whole series of events outdoors where we cooked up a feast on a grand dinner table in front of an amazing view with after dinner speakers, where we were trying to be very inclusive, make a space that was open to all to respect and discuss and reflect everyone's views. And these are some images of them. This is Askham in Furness, on the top is Walney Island. Another project that we work on is very much around food, futures and biodiversity, but it's a project called Allotment Soup, which is an ongoing sort of project. It started off just as 1 year, and I think we're on the sixth for now. It's on Walney Island, and it's a community growing space. And this is it before it got some plants growing on it in an amazing mud bath, but really a project that developed from local people and how they wanted to access the environment and the land and have growing spaces in a place that is full of dense terraces. Part of this project really is about creating a welcome to everybody and valuing everyone and making every interaction the best it can be, however small that interaction is, whether it's a conversation, some food, some growing, looking at biodiversity, climate change. So it's scooping all those things into it. And this is a project we do annually. And these are a series of moth traps, which in a way give over everything that I suppose that we're wanting to embrace, which is really about risks and ideas, and the fact that we're interested in landscape, heritage, future and communities. And then the built, which is the sort of last section that we work on. So it's social first, natural, built. And this is a set of pods that we created over in Roca in Sunderland. And they sort of, in a way, represent what we're talking about too with the built, which is anything from the unloved. Often we're working in areas like that too, and certainly Roca was. The listed, the vernacular, industrial, scheduled, I can never say that right, and the unsanctioned. So all those places, again, no hierarchy, we're inclusive, we're interested in them all. And these are structures that go down onto the beach and form spaces to engage people. This is for sort of pond dipping, etc., on the beach. And there are three different event space. One is a cafe, one is a performance space, and the other is an education space. And what we're trying to do here is really create a culture of invention and imagination, which positively embraces risk as an opportunity for change. That's the inside. It's quite big. That's me. And then we can take them down onto the beach, in behind the beach cleaning tractor here. So it's really, I suppose, pushing the envelope always with either with people or with structures or places or things that we're doing, where we're tackling that imagination deficit. The fact that you can't do it often is the thing that inspires me to try and have a go. So we're always trying to raise aspiration by creating the best quality work. And I think I would add here for everyone, and the best quality work that we can do is constantly changing and moving. And I think that learning process is a big key thing that we are doing. Excuse me. And these were hides in South Walney. That's what the last image was. And this is the interior where we're working on those things that are not seen outside the hides, but all of the stuff to do with the history of the area and the environment, to make the place more accessible for people in different weather conditions and with different abilities. And then lastly, never forget that humour is a very powerful way to engage. You can get over many things if you not make light, but make it accessible by being humorous. And often I do that within my work. And this is an inflated terraced house from Barrow, which I took on a tour around the county. And this is it over in Carlisle, and then on the beach down near where we are, just to show you that it does deflate again. There's my details, and that is me. So I will escape.
Thank you, Maddie.
Okay.
That's great to have seen. Love a pod, love food, love dinner, love an inflated house. What's not to like about any of those things? And again, some questions raised there, as well as some really interesting examples of work that is going on, has been going on in this county. I'm aware that I'm just looking at chat. There's all sorts of stuff been going on in chat. We've got sort of five, maybe a few more minutes than that, just to engage in a bit of a debate now. I'm going to keep it tight because I want to make sure we finish at 11. I think, Natalie, you're on this call for the first time. Natalie Robinson, I think you wanted to say a couple of things, Natalie. Just remind us who you are, and off you go. Can't hear you, Natalie, so just put your microphone down again.
Sorry, that was a bit silly. My name is Natalie Robinson. I'm a student OT. A drama teacher taught me how to read. My pronouns are she, her and hers. I'm a member of the LGBTQ community. The listening to the dialogue in the chat stream, one of the things I picked up on was how do we use another word for engaging? There are different words to use to want people to come to the table. Empowerment. We facilitate connection with communities and individuals. We use first person language, and that's visible on our website. So my a lived in experience example of this would be a person with autism. Now, the easiest way to sort of explain that would be that my autism is this loom, and by putting it down, I can leave it with somebody else when I walk out the room. So using that and examining our own privileges, how am I privileged? So where are the accessibility issues going to be a challenge? So how am I privileged? I'm privileged because I can speak. Sometimes I go selectively mute. I'm privileged because I can hear. I'm privileged because I can see. I'm privileged because I can mobilize up steps. So when we walk around an environment and we take into consideration the social model of disability and we examine that space, forgive me if anybody already has this on their radar, and I'm already speaking in terms that people have done this training in, it's being present in that environment and saying, okay, I'm accessing this because I can do X. If I couldn't do X, how would I not be accessing it? And how do I empower people to the table? If it's focus groups, are we ensuring that we continue to have captions? Do we have a BSL signer? If it's a case of there's a mobility access issue, is it that we work around that? Or actually, not is it that we work around that? Is it simply just a matter of course?
Okay. Thank you, Natalie. Great questions. I'm just, Curtis, I'm looking at what you've put into chat there. I feel the same about the word disadvantage. I'm always asking who is excluded because of others' advantages. Do you want to just elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm doing quite a lot of work still back where I've spent kind of most of my life in Brighton around education and disadvantage, which is the language that is used a lot. And I posed a question to the local authority the other day about, you know, instead of asking the community, how can we help you with your disadvantage? Why don't we come into the local authority and ask you, how can we help you understand your advantage and how that excludes other people and how that keeps that disadvantage going? And I think it's the same in the arts world. You know, I'm always sort of using this phrase, how do we design ourselves out of a job? You know, when we're thinking about the work we're doing, how do we have some sort of roadmap that means that we're not just getting a load of people from disadvantaged backgrounds to volunteer for the work, but those people end up running the companies. Those people end up taking the money for doing that work, and that we remove ourselves from some of that work and move on to other things.
Thanks, Curtis. I'm just picking up also, Andrew, you replied to someone who said we're all part of the problem, and you said, Andrew Deacon, we're all part of the solution too. Andrew, tell us, that's a positive statement to make.
Yeah, I mean, it's a truism as well, in that we sometimes do a lot of staring at belly buttons, trying to work out what we're doing wrong and how we should do things right, when in fact we should just act. There's just a couple of things I'd like to add to that. One is I grew up in the Salvation Army, and there's a role in the Salvation Army which is the door sergeant, and my dad was a door sergeant, and that sounds like one of the reasons was to keep drunks out in the early part of last century, but it was also to encourage people who were drunk in as well. And the big thing that a door sergeant has is the ability to welcome people and to make them feel welcome in a place. And some of the easiest things for us to do are say hello to people, smile, ask them about themselves in every aspect of what we're doing within organisations and without, and we should do far more of that. The other thing I'd like to add is that there's a common denominator that we don't really talk about very much in a lot of the areas around inclusivity and access, and it's to do with class and disposable income. If you have got a disability and are well off, there are all sorts of ways you can find around your disability. If you're poor and have got a disability, it's just another addition to the problems you have. And I think we need to talk about class and disposable income a little bit more to see whether there are things we can address there. I know Kim Moore, one of the things that Kim does with the Kendall Poetry Festival is to have free tickets. It's a really simple thing. And to have a really simple way where no one gets embarrassed, where no one needs to feel any sort of shame, to make tickets available so that people are not not disadvantaged because they can't afford a ticket. Yeah, but we're all part of the solution, and we can just get on with it and not beat ourselves up because we're not perfect, because it'll never be done. The work will never be done, really.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you. Great contribution. And I feel like, you know, I'm going to go back through chats at the end of this, and just this is stirring up stuff for when we get together again, regroup in September, and actually look at some practical solutions, hopefully face to face at Rose Hill. Thank you for that, Andrew. I'm going to come to Kate Parry, who is our chair, to summarise some reflections in this meeting in 5 minutes or so. But first of all, I just wanted to hand back to Jane Dudman at Prism, just to talk a little bit about what's coming up as far as Prism is concerned. Jane, over to you.
Hi, thanks, Tom. Thanks, everybody, for those talks and presentations. It was just great to see that variety of approaches to this issue. And I should say also that Prism Arts, we're very much on a journey. You know, you might think as an organisation, because that's our very raison d'etre, is to work with people with disabilities and looking at inclusion. But we are constantly looking at that within our organisation as well, and we are definitely on a journey, nowhere near solving the issues that we have, and to that end, really the step up program that the symposium is the sort of culmination of was brought about because we needed to look at how we support progression for our artists throughout our organization, because traditionally, although we're not a day service, we're absolutely an arts organisation. People with learning disabilities and autism who have a personal budget come to us and are used to doing a session, an art session, and then doing another art session, and just keeping on coming. And people come for years and years. And we really wanted to look at how do we progress people through the organisation, and exactly what you were saying, Curtis, so that actually we're no longer needed, because we shouldn't be here to keep people with us. We should be here to enable people to leave Prism Arts and be independent as artists. So this whole programme step up is absolutely about that and was driven by that endeavour. Now, we started the Step Up programme, which is funded by Esme Fairbairn Foundation, and it funded me as the project manager and costs before the pandemic. And a big part of that was working with the university to look at teaching and learning, to look at what adjustments are necessary, to look at what the university does and how inclusive that teaching and learning is, but also to look at actually how people with learning disabilities and autism can access specialist equipment, facilities and tutors, and also a learning environment, and how those artists can actually enrich that environment, but how they can be part of something where everybody is working towards progressing their work. Everyone is on that same journey. How can artists be part of that environment where everyone's on that same artistic journey as equals, not in a silo, not as a, oh, this is the group who are doing that thing on their own and this is the rest of the university, but actually how can we work together? So it's a proper partnership, and it's a partnership between our artists and students and staff as well. So a mega sort of thing to try and do. So we started it off, then the pandemic hit and we were completely not working. We weren't running any sessions. Everything had to stop. University, even when people started, a really big rethink about the project. And during that time, we were also looking at different aspects of this progression project, which were looking at opportunities to deliver and develop work externally, so external representation for our artists. And we did some online projects with Tully House and with Bolton Museum, where our artists were commissioned to make work we have an exhibition of one of our artists, Harvey's, doing a solo exhibition at the Fratery, the new gallery at the Cathedral in Carlisle. And we've had some of his work professionally screen printed. So it's constantly, we're constantly looking at actually how we elevate that work, how we, it's looking at the work in a way that appreciates what it is, not looking at, it's not professional. Actually, how do we actually look at that work? How do we represent that work? And traditionally, sounds daft, but things like quality of materials, really, really important. So the Step Up program really helped us fund, because the funding is really, really important, because we're working with people who are on benefits, working with people who have a very small income, couldn't afford to buy professional quality materials. So the program has also funded that. As part of what's happened with Step Up is that it's enabled us to really push the whole agenda of progression for our artists throughout the organisation. So when I first joined, this was like a project that sat over here, progression, and everything just carried on in the same way. And gradually over time, those two things have come together. So the progression is really at the heart of all our programs, our studio programs and our external projects. And that has like been a real turnaround.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
As a result of all this work, we're doing this symposium. The symposium is about inclusive practice. It's about the work that we've been doing with Cumbria University. It's about the Step Up program. We're bringing national organisations who are arts organisations working inclusive practice to Carlisle to talk about their experience of university partnerships. There's lots of workshops happening that are co-delivered by our artists. There are talks, there's an exhibition. So it's a real opportunity for our artists to experience that progression, but also thinking about peer networks and joining in the national conversation around this issue is really important. And this symposium is the first of its kind anywhere nationally, and other organisations I've talked to have said, this is really important. We really need this to happen. It really needs to be pushed, this agenda. Actually, how do we access higher education, further education in a way that is completely integrated? How do we do that? And how do we do that in partnership with universities? So it's a, if you're able to come along, all the information's gone out. Tom sent all that out.
So it's the 5th of July, also, I think, isn't it? 5th of July.
It's 5th of July, and on the 6th, we are having a morning of conversation to really interrogate the issues. And if any of you are interested in coming on to that, that's an invitation only, so you need to email me.
Okay.
And if you're interested in coming along to that, we have those national organisations talking there and being part of the discussion. But the more people we can have in that space with different views and different approaches, the better and the more dynamic and productive ultimately it will be. Because we want to end up with something that is useful and not just talking. Yeah.
Thank you. Amy's put the link to the symposium in the chat already. Jane, perhaps if you'd like to put your details in the chat as well. So that people can contact you, that would be fantastic. And as you say, it's about action. That symposium sounds like
it is
action. All right, yeah. Thank you ever so much. And thank you, Jane. Okay, we're coming up towards the end of our meeting now. So I'm just gonna hand to Kate, who is our chair, just to reflect on what we've been hearing about for the last 90 minutes or so. Kate.
There's lots, isn't there? There's so much. It's such a vast topic, but it's been fascinating. And I've heard and enjoyed and been stimulated by every word that everyone has said. Thank you so much for opening up and sharing those examples, and the comments have been fascinating too. Yesterday I was lucky enough to go to the celebration opening of Wordsworth Grasmere and met Kevin, who, Jeff might correct me, Kevin is from Park Hill Poets. He is a disabled adult who is fantastic, and he appears on one of the screens and one of the films in the new Wordsworth Museum. And he was there at the opening yesterday, and it was so nice to chat to him and to see his confidence and his pride in what he'd done. It was really, really special. So do go along and see that. Which is great that Kevin was there. I wanted to just, there are so many things that have stood out, but in terms of, you know, how do we do better, it feels like it's all about us doing things differently. It's about the need to, I think Celia said, humble ourselves. It's about the need to listen and really listen, which Celia said and Maddie backed up. It's about being generous and caring and genuine in what we do. It's about being open, opening our minds and generating this culture of learning such as they're doing at Theatre by the Lake. But I think what Dave said about staying critical of our own discourse is really important, not just sitting here and congratulating ourselves for having done some good stuff. We know we have, but as many people have said, there is so much to do and it's such a complicated subject. But as Andrew said, we can make a difference by just cracking on and taking action. I want to point you to the Arts Council Equality, Diversity and Inclusion report, which has just come out today and appeared magically on the screen in front of you. In fact, I think it came out yesterday. That's about how we're doing sort of state of the nation report across Arts Council funded organisations. So do have a look at that. I think somebody mentioned, Jane, I think it was you, about how the process of applying for Arts Council funding is a massive barrier in itself. And I'm sure there are many, many, many people here who will agree with that. So, I stick my neck out and saying there is such a massive, massive irony in the production of that report. But it's important stuff. And, you know, we need to read what is being said and understand the bigger picture and where we fit. So yeah, there is much, much more to say and much, much more to talk about. And, you know, as somebody who works across organisations, one thing that is on my mind is how we square all this massively important work around inclusivity with the need to run organisations and pay the bills, especially in a time of recovery from COVID when the visitors aren't necessarily there and costs are rising. So that's not a get out, it's not an excuse, it's just that is the reality of the context we're working in, and it's one of the things that we've got to think about how we do both, and possibly if you get one right the other becomes easier, but it's not easy. So maybe that's something we can pick up in September. So we invite you to join us on the 16th of September, it's a Friday, in person. If we can get it online as well, we will, because that's obviously all part of the inclusion. But we would like to see you in person if possible, where we'll hear from a range of people with a range of lived experience, and hopefully from the Arts Council as well. Rose Hill Theatre, Friday the 16th of September, much more details to follow on that. Thank you so much indeed. Thank you to Tom for pulling it all together as usual, and for all of you for being here. Tom.
Thank you, Kate. Thanks to Jane, Jonathan, Simon, Dave, Jeff, Maddie, Celia, to other people that have contributed in chat, and to people that have just listened as well. There's nothing like a bit of listening. It's what an art form and skill that is in itself. I think we're at half time. We've started the conversation. We've already had a conversation going, I know, but formally, to spend 90 minutes on a Friday morning to talk about this stuff. For me, it's got stuff buzzing in my head. I'm looking forward to regrouping in September. I would encourage you to think about the Prism Symposium that Jane talked about on the 5th of July, and keep talking with each other and to each other as well, and to others who aren't here, to see how we can make this county as inclusive and as relevant as we possibly can in the arts and culture sector. So thank you for your time this morning. I'm off to the Kendal Poetry Festival this evening, actually. So I'm looking forward to the launch of that in Kendal. And I hope you will have nice cultural artistic times before we next meet again as well. I can't remember what we're doing next Friday, but it'll be something fantastic and worth coming along to. So thank you again, and see you all again soon. Bye-bye.